Welcome to the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am back. For you guys, for everyone listening, it has been a week. For me, it's been about a month since I've recorded an interview, so hopefully, fingers crossed, this will go well. Considering my last, 200 interviews have went okay, this, well, would be an improvement. I am joined on this podcast by someone that we've interacted quite a lot over the years, but we've never actually physically met. I don't think we've actually had a conversation like this before, which is weird, but, you know, it's nice. But I'm joined by Discovery Wrestling's very own international broadcast analyst himself. It's Darren T Goss. Welcome to the show.
Well, thank you. I really welcomed you then. This is a fantastic start, as I thought it would be. Also, I want to apologize to all the people out there in TV world. I don't have my laptop working. I couldn't get my tablet to work, so I'm on my phone, which means I've got to hold it. Not in a good place, so you see in my barren greenback, like bullfrog jaw, but there's not a lot we can do about that. So there you go. That's how we start off things, is me talking about my fat jaw.
That's okay. We've had past guests. We've had some from up in the Northeast whose internet doesn't work in the Granite City. So we've had ones that have just been stutters the whole way through. And we've had a guest at one point just do it like they were at a party and just went into like a back room to do it to record for half an hour. And it was very weird because they're all glammed up. And I was just there in a scrubby t-shirt going, "How do you like wrestling?" So you're fine. It's going to be good.
We're okay. I'm in the front of my house, which is where the internet's best. So
I am in my office where the internet is okay. So
okay.
Nice. I'm in the sticks. I'm in Elgin. That's just, internet is a luxury.
Oh, I'm in the Wells Valleys. You know, I'm surprised we got electricity here. Let's be honest. Look, I'm going there now. I don't know where. Look, you're on a wacky journey with me, folks. There. It's like the Blair Witch Project. That's worse. Anyway, let's get on with it rather than me looking myself.
So you're from the sticks, I'm from the sticks. You know, how's that lights doing?
Originally I'm from Cardiff, which is quite a dignified place, but I'm here now. So there we go. Yeah.
So let's do an interview then.
Let's do an interview. Why not?
It's clearly been too few weeks since I've done this, so I can't remember how to start a podcast. How'd you get into wrestling? So that's the easy question. What was your moment? What was your catalyst for loving this wrestling thing?
Well, I was part of the 1990-1991 phase, which kicked off over here. I remember, so say 91, I had Sky, and there was a friend of mine that didn't have Sky, and he wanted to see WrestleMania 7. So I said, I'll tape it for you, which would have been on Sky Movies at the time. So I went to tape it, but much like every other bit of technology I've got, my video recorder wasn't working. So I had to watch it. Now, I've never seen wrestling before, so I'm trying to explain what's happening to it. Like, he picked him up, he dropped him on the floor, then I don't know what's going on. Half the time I'd forget to put down who won the matches, and by three quarters of the way in, I was bored out of my mind and I just gave up. So not the best review. Probably better than Meltzer, but you know, no stars for that. However, somewhere in between then and SummerSlam 91, oh my God, this phone. Let's just say that. Somewhere in between there and SummerSlam 91, I was hooked. And I remember being disappointed to go on holiday because I meant I would miss SummerSlam 91. So that was the point for me, was in between WrestleMania 7, SummerSlam 91. I was hooked in it then, and I've sort of, unlike everyone else I knew as a kid who grew out of it in a year or two, and as my family hoped I'd grow out of it, I didn't. And here I am now, a decrepit old man, still watching Men in Pants pretending to fight.
Kindred spirits there, because I think that's the same. Although it's weird that I'm actually speaking to someone who, because everyone I've kind of spoke to or know has been the guy that got the tapes from their pal that had Sky Box Office or Sky Movies or
here
there. It's nice to speak to someone who was on the other side of it.
Way back, we had a remote control on the video recorder, but it was joined by a lead, and it would play, stop, fast forward, wouldn't rewind. I don't know why. There you go. No pause button either. Which you needed to know, people out there. Yeah,
kids these days don't know that they're born.
They don't know they're born. They don't know the joys of a video recorder not working, and you'd have to press the bottom and the tape would eject at the top. So, yeah.
And I've got a bunch of tapes up in my parents' loft that's going to have, I'll have to check out each and every one before I can even use it for mold. And like, you just, it's just no, not a problem nowadays. Kids just are given things.
I've got hundreds up there, and I don't watch them, but I can't dare to part with them either.
Yeah, absolutely same. I've got about 300 tapes, and I'm just like, no, they're staying. I need to pop in December to dismember, as it was on Sky Box Office, someday in the future.
And hope the tape breaks,
maybe, but no, it's just, one of those things. I'm just like, I can't get rid of them. Anyway, so
I was just going to say, there's one other thing as we go along here now. In December, early December of 1991, there was a wrestling show near me, and they were advertising Sergeant Slaughter, which was never going to happen because he was working for WWF. But of course, I don't know that. And a lot of people didn't know that either, and he drew quite a good house. Now, surprisingly, in the intermission, the promoter came out, and I don't know. I've tried to find out who ran this show. I have no idea. And said, unfortunately, Sergeant Slaughter's plane has been delayed and he's not going to be here. Okay. So, however, I did see Big Daddy in the main event. I got his autograph after, and he called me weird because I said he smelled funny. So that was my initial interaction with my first interaction with a wrestler. Now, the funny smell, for anyone who's ever been in a locker room, will know that the usual smell is links and knee pads, because I don't think anyone has any idea how bad knee pads smell. It's the worst part of being a wrestler. And when I see anyone put anyone in a head scissors or something, I would tap straight away just to have those knee pads around you. Good God. But yeah, so
it's better or worse than some of the front rows that you've interacted with.
No comment. Let's just say I move around a lot sometimes as a manager. I did. I used to move around a lot. But people were people. I never got attacked up in Scotland when I managed, but I did get attacked in Wales. So I suppose that's a compliment to me.
Absolutely. Somehow. So is it always
in the street? I get attacked in the street lots of times, but you can't blame people in here, you know.
Was it always managing that you were drawn to initially, or do you just enjoy watching?
It always was, because my guy started off as Jimmy Hart, and Hulk Hogan, and they consistently stayed. And I was the kid that always liked Skeletor in He-Man and Mumra and Thundercats. I was always drawn to the more villainous type of character, rather than the face, rather than the baby face. So Jimmy Hart, to me, coming out with his megaphone, the colorful suits and everything, I was just totally drawn to that. And I don't have an athletic bone in my body. And I realized at that point I could never do it, but my dream was to get out there and manage. But of course, in 1991, an 11-year-old kid, I had no idea how I could possibly formulate that plan. And the people I did ask then later in school said, well, if you're going to be a manager, you're going to need a financial degree. You're going to need this, that, and the other. Because they're looking at it from a completely different thing, as if I'm going to be a shoot manager. And I'm thinking, well, I can't do any of that. So that was as a kid. And then I realized, oh, hang on, I just need to go and stand out there and shout. But then I learned there was a lot more to it than that. But we're jumping way ahead now. So
we'll kind of get into a little bit of middle point. So you said Hulk Hogan, Jimmy Hart was your favorites growing up. Was it always WWF? I don't know if.
No, I love WCW as well. So I'd say it was Flair came into WWF in 91, and I was instantly drawn to him as well, because so was the heels. I always liked the heels. So my two then and my two now would always be Hogan and Flair. It's just been a consistent for me as we go along. And so, yeah, I'd watch WWF, I'd watch WCW, I'd watch EC. You know, that 1997 arguably has to be looked at as the greatest year for wrestling. You had WWF firing on all cylinders with the Hart Foundation and the rise of Austin. You had WCW with the NWO and the Sting angle. You had ECW going on as well, and they had loads of stuff going on there. But I wasn't a massive ECW fan because it was difficult to watch. You know, you'd have to trade tapes to go in there, and I was more concerned of getting the WCW pay-per-views. So I could watch the others, but there was no way of watching WCW pay-per-views over here. So it would be a trade of them in, and they wouldn't be the great commentary. Well, commentary wouldn't be the greatest of quality. But Yeah, so those were the main things really for me, but those three companies growing up, and then the tragedy in 2001 when they all went. Ever since then, it's been, for me personally, much less of an interest in wrestling.
Much less of a priority to watch. It's more a case of just...
Yeah, because, you know, there's no competition, even with WWE and AEW, because they're not directly opposite each other. I know they did the NXT thing, but they said it's just not the same, you know? It's just not the same that Raw and Nitro were, and it was... And I think because there's no social media, that was another one. Wonderful thing at the time as well. So as good as the internet and everything for that has been, I think it's hurt wrestling for a lot of people as well.
He says
doing an interview with you over the internet now on a podcast.
Because it's ease of access that's ruined things quite a bit. Because before, I mean, I got into wrestling about 98, 99. So I missed that 97 buzz that you're talking about, even though I do hear, I listen to a lot of OSW review, and they go on about 97 like it's the best year ever. So eventually, maybe
I can't see any other year beating it because you're never going to have those companies again putting on that level of with those level of stars. You know, look at it, Austin, Brett, then you had Hogan, Macho, Sting. You had all those guys, you know, and I don't think you're not going to get that again. You're just not because of how people wrestle these days, and how people, if they don't come through a machine where they all wrestle exactly the same, or they wrestle a style of wrestling that I don't think draws the casual person to it. I really don't. I just think, but there we are. We're not going to get into that because everyone calls me old fashioned, but that's fine. So I'm going to be good. I'm going to behave.
Well, hopefully I might change that if I throw my opinions. But no, it's like for me, AEW, I can't get into it. I've tried, but it's just not. It's not for me. It's not aimed at me. Because I'm just
no. Well, that's what you got to look at. Wrestling isn't aimed for me either. You know, but if people like it, it's fine. If people, you know, that is the main thing. It doesn't matter what goes on a wrestling show as long as the fans like it. Yeah. And that's it. We can't all be the same.
Oh, if we were, that would be terrible.
Would be terrible. I don't want to be like you, you know. See, I can't help it. I got to throw the heel side in every now and then.
So from that point onwards, then, how did you go from wanting to be a manager, being told that you're going to have to get a business degree and learn how to do acquisitions, to actually going, oh, this is a place where I can learn to do this? How did that go?
I will shock you by saying I didn't actually get a business degree. I was talking to to somebody over MySpace. Now, at that time, there we go, that's a dated thing. Through the UK Fan Forum, which was huge at the time. That's where, if you're a wrestling fan, you were on that UK Fan Forum. And I can't think of his name. Chris Hansen. Sorry, Chris. Which isn't his real name anyway, but there you go. He looked like he had long blonde hair and everything, long blonde hair, and he looked like he was in Hanson, so he was given that name. And I was talking to him, and he was a trainee wrestler. So I met up with him because, as I said, I didn't know anyone that watched wrestling. It was just me, literally, up until this time I met him, which had been 2008. And I went, we had to chat and a couple of drinks. It wasn't a date. There was, it's not that sort of thing. And he said that he had to go to training. I thought he meant like football training, but he was going to wrestling training. So I said, do you think there's any chance I can pop along and just watch? You know, because I'm fascinated by this whole thing, because I never seen anything or done anything like that before. And he said, yeah, no problem. So I went in there, paid money to sit there and watch it, which I was fine to do, like other trainees would. And I got to know people. I got to meet people. The training, it was called a Celtic Wrestling. It was run by wrestler named Cayman. Jason Cross would come in as well as a trainer. And Jason had been around for ages. He'd done tours of Japan, and he was, you know, still is, really. He does a lot of work up in WAW with Ricky Knight. And he's a really, really good trainer. He knows the old British style, and there we are. So, and Cayman had been around for a while in the Welsh wrestling scene as well. So they were really good to me, and they let me come on and play really with them. And So it was a couple of weeks of watching that, and then they said, right, if you want to be a manager, we were in a, there was no wrestling rings. So again, this is what a lot of people who go to training, there was no wrestling rings for these guys. There was a crash mat and then really thin little match with little mats where they do their flip bumps, they do their bumps and everything. So they do have it too good today. If you're training in a ring, I'm like, come on. You should be bumping on tiny, minute little mats like that. So I did the world's worst promo I can imagine. So one of the trainees stood next to me and put a mask on, which to this day I have no idea why. I just blithered a load of crap, which I blocked it out mentally. It must have been so bad. And they were like, yeah, that was all right. You can be on the next show if you want. So I was like, okay, great. So that was the initial start. And then the first show I did, I went there with the thought of being a manager. And the guy there who was the gimmick general manager sort of figure hadn't turned up. So they said, you're going to have to be an acting general manager and come out. And basically what the idea was for the match, it was a tag title match. There were two from Ireland. They were called Captain Rooney and Connor Hurley. And they were the tag champs. And they were facing a tag team called Method and Madness, who really did, you know, well in Wales at that moment. They were quite a well-known tag team. So my job was to come out there and, God, this is bad, and to say, right, because who was it? Captain Rooney, who had like a Superman gimmick. Now, I'm sure I keep meaning to ask some of the Irish boys if they've heard of these guys. And so Captain Hurley didn't turn up. So there was just Connor Hurley there. I had to go out and say, if you don't find a tag partner within a minute, you're going to be stripped of the titles. Okay. So I went out there, played the Summer of 69 as my entrance music. Again, no idea why. Out I stormed, a million miles an hour, totally nervous, petrified in front of, which was probably about 150 people. I grabbed the mic and I just froze. I didn't know what to say. I had no idea. Now, thank God, Connor Hurley turned his back to the crowd and mouthed some of the words of what I needed to say and totally saved my ass. And then when I got into it, I finished what I was supposed to say. Awful, absolutely terrible. But you, and even now, the last time I would come, because I commentate now and you don't have the same thing as when you come out there. But I will always say to people, if you don't have those butterflies before you go out there, and maybe this isn't really for you, because that means you care what you're doing. But unfortunately, it can be really intimidating, especially when you first start. And I don't think a lot of people realize that. But when you go out there in front of a live crowd, it can be really chaotic to begin with. So, yeah, and you balls up. But as long as you don't mess up to the degree, as long as you don't hurt anyone, you know, then it doesn't matter. You're learning. And I think a lot of people will go out there and really overanalyze and over-criticize people. And unfortunately, the fans do that as well. Because I think the fans, oh, here we go. I'm having to go with the fans now. This is great. I don't mean to, but because they're so much of wrestling is open and they feel they do know everything that goes on, but they really don't. It's difficult to put into words. So when they're openly criticizing somebody for doing a mistake and then other people jump on board that, it can really mess with people mentally, you know, especially if you're a young guy or girl and you're just coming up and then you're just hounded on the internet for doing something wrong, you know, and that can be really difficult. But again, you're going to have to pull me back, because as anyone knows me, I will go off on tangents.
That's absolutely fine. If tangents seem to be a running thing on this. Don't know if you've ever spent the hours watching our Scottie Swift chats. They're like 2.5 hours where I ask like five yeah. questions. But when it comes to, I think you're right, because I've noticed, like, I don't follow a lot of like wrestling accounts on Twitter because I don't care what their thought is. That's the kind of main thing of it. I'll follow the wrestlers, I'll follow the promotions that I need to couple folk that I know, that's about it. Because yeah, I don't care what Dave Meltzer thinks. That's the kind of, and then usually it's going to be people parroting what Dave Meltzer thinks. So
yeah, and I think a lot of it is you will see that opinion online and you think, oh right, well they don't like this, they don't like that. I can't like it either. Mm-hmm. So that you go and watch it then, and where you may have otherwise just enjoy it, you've got this mindset now. Oh, I don't like it because they've done this backstage, or they've done this, or they've done that. Instead of just watching it, you know, because people are human beings, and I'm not on about the speaking out stuff, you know, but it's a business. There are always going to be politics backstage. Mm-hmm. It's always going to be the case. And I think for a lot of people, when they open up and say, oh, somebody wasn't happy with this creative and this, that, it's a lot of this, you know, just crap. How do they know? Oh, so I read something where it said, oh, CM Punk and Tony Khan had a meeting and this happened. I'm like, well, how do you know what happened if two people had a meeting in a room? You don't know. You have no idea. Even if one of those individuals comes out and tells you certain things, they're only telling you their side of it. So I think there is a large population now of wrestling fans, unfortunately, and we're all guilty of it, who just love the gossip. Mm-hmm. And that does take away from, certainly I'm looking at it as my point of view as a fan. When I was a kid, there was no internet. You would sit and watch something, and if you liked them, you liked them. If you didn't, you didn't. So I do feel sad for a lot of people I've spoken to, wrestlers and everything. And as you say, for yourself, you missed that 97 year. But also for me, going back to 91, 92, 30 plus years ago, it is astronomically different how wrestling is today. So a lot of old people like me do struggle at times. But again, look, I love the fans. I think they're great. Without them, they don't exist. I love the passion. I love the passion they had for Celtic wrestling. And I absolutely love the passion so many of the fans have for Discovery as well. And I'm talking about the absolute minority that caused problems. Yeah. The majority of fans are fantastic. And the Discovery fans especially have always been absolutely great to all of us. And without them, there wouldn't be any Discovery shows anyway. So that's it. The Discovery exists because of them and for them. Same with any other kind.
This seems to be a podcast of me just making a point and going, yeah, I absolutely agree when it comes to it.
Good. That's how life should be for me always.
But this, in the same token, is of course when I do reviews, it's very different. You can see which ones I do that I've watched on YouTube and what I've been there live, because the ones I've been there live are more passionate because I'm just taking in the show. I watch it on YouTube.
Yeah, cool.
You've got your, I know the results or I've got a preconception from comments and that, but it's always nice to see, even if you have been critical of someone, seeing how well they've gone on to become. Like the one that I always point is Omar Muhammad. I saw his first match on YouTube, hated it. I didn't like him either. And now he's probably one of the best, most underrated in the country, I would say, when it comes to being an entertaining entity in wrestling. So it's a great to see that kind of evolution, and without that kind of access.
And again, it's a build. It's so difficult to do it, because I used to love drama and doing things like that. And it's the only thing I can compare it to is that, because you're going out there in front of a live crowd. But unlike drama, which is, you know, so infinitely, I got to use the word choreographed, you know, because you know absolutely everything that's going to go on. You can try, and I get it. You've got to have some sort of choreography for wrestling, but you've also got to be aware of, right, if this doesn't work, you can't just stand there. As I always say, there you are, you've got the deer in headlights moment, where you'll see in a match, mm-hmm. people just stop because they don't know what to do, and they just, you know, grab a headlock and then go from there. And I think you talk about Omar, you talk about anyone at all that you I see so many of these guys, and I want them to do well. That I want this camera to do well as well. That is more, if I could be just taken up to Discovery or any other show and just be backstage and talk to some of these guys and pass on whatever little knowledge I have, just and mainly help build their confidence, because I've seen a lot of people that were trainees just get completely knocked down and quit. And I think that's so unfair that bullies do that. And there was a lot of people, I'm not going to name them because what's the point? But there's a lot of people who are bullies, you know, and there's going to be. And I don't see it anymore now, but it's just going to happen. It's life. So I certainly saw it in the past. Things are a lot better now, thank God. But and sometimes they'll need that. They need that bit of reassurance and someone just to pull them aside and say, look, things aren't going to be great for you when you go out there. You know, don't expect it to be. Mm-hmm. Don't put yourself on a pedestal where you're really, really worried and this has got to go perfect. This has got to go perfect. Because it's never going to. But the fans don't know that.
That's it.
And I think a lot of people forget it. If they miss something up or it doesn't look great, again, my rule of thumb is always, as long as you don't hurt anyone, mm-hmm. you know, much like I'm going to do to this phone in a minute, as long as you don't hurt anyone, it doesn't matter. The fans are only going to, they don't have a playlist in front of them, the fans, that says, right, this move, all these things are going to happen in order. So if something does go, again, if something goes wrong in a match when you hurt someone, if something doesn't go exactly as you've planned it, don't worry about it. Just grab a headlock and go for something else. But I've seen people go backstage. I've seen people at a very high level talk to me and I've had to go have a go at them because they annoy me, beating themselves up because something hasn't gone exactly as they wanted it to go. It's like, well, it's life. Just deal with it. So, again, that's a tangent. I've no idea. So where am I now? I'm starting managing. My first official act as a manager is online, but I'm not going to tell you what it is. It was in a Royal Rumble. I came out with somebody in a completely silver bodysuit with silver face paint named Twilight, who was part of a tag team called Twilight Number One and Number Two. And I can see you trying to look with your fingers. You're not going to find it. And he was barefoot. So that was my thing. And backstage as a joke, they decided to completely soak my crotch.
Soak.
Yeah,
just there was a little bit of a delay there that may have sounded like something else.
They decided to bleep my crotch. Yeah. No, they decided to soak my crotch as if I'd go out there and it would look like I've completely wet myself. Fortunately for me, I was wearing these like sandy tan colored trousers, so didn't really stand up. But there's a lovely photo, which if you want, I will send to you, of me managing in this match, shouting at the guy I'm managing. And then in the background, there are a couple in the crowd with a very passionate embrace, having a good old snog, which I don't blame them. You know, it was very erotic, that match, and seeing me out there, obviously, with my soaking wet crotch, and also somebody in a completely full white silver bodysuit pretending to know what he's doing would get anyone going. So there we go.
Oh, I love wrestling. It's just the weirdest thing in the world. So that was your first taste of it.
That was my first taste, and I was known as, oh God, I wasn't known as, oh God, I was known as the Goss Father, which is a name I gave myself, which I thought, oh, this will be clever, the Goss Father. Obviously a play on the Godfather, and it was Gilligan Gordon, though I think he's still, you know, Gilligan's great, he was a manager at the time there with me, and he's the first person that really led me to do what I wanted to, what I've always wanted to do, which is sort of pull people aside and, you know, give them a bit of advice as best as I can. He did that to me. So he sat down with me and he said, right, what does it mean? What is your character? What is your gimmick as the Goss Father? And literally it was just, I like the name. And of course he's right. There's nothing to it. So I pretty much ditched that. And I thought, well, I know a character I can do. I can just be me. I could just use my name, which was mainly because I think I'd forget. My worry was if I gave myself a name like, oh, I don't know, Bloody Eric or something, I'd forget that name and just call myself, which has happened on commentary a few times. Unfortunately, I've called certain wrestlers by their real names, which does slip through every now and then, even though I'm the greatest commentator from the street where I live. That was an issue for me. So I call myself Darren T. Goss, which is my real full name. But in promos, I do like, oh, the T stands for tremendous. The T stands for terrifying, which is what this match will be for you tonight. So it was breakdown, and a lot of it was, there was no school to learn how to be a manager. So for me, it was just watch and shoot interviews of Cornette. There were a few with Heenan as well, because that was my guy, Heenan. If it wasn't for him, that's why I wanted to do it. I admitted that earlier on, but that was my guy, Bobby Heenan, who was arguably one of the greatest ever, because he could do everything. He could wrestle, he could talk, he could bump, he could, you know, he could do it all. He could absolutely do it all. So that was, he wasn't my motivation to do it. It was, motivation, but he wasn't my inspiration, because I'm not the guy that can go flying around the ring. I quickly drew on the fact that I'm 6'2". I'm a lot larger than the other people I'm managing, be it in height and in size. So quickly I adapted. After we did a gimmick where I got super kicked and I wore a neck brace for one or two shows, which is, don't ever do that. That's really painful. I had no idea. Don't wear a neck brace unless you have to. And so I took the super kick, went down and started using a walking stick because it would give me a bit of a disadvantage. You know, oh, he's using a walking stick rather than there's a huge guy. He's not going to be able to beat people up. Can we just stop it there 1 second? Are you able to hear my cockatiel in the background?
A little bit, yeah.
Right. Give me 1 second. I'm going to try. I put him out the kitchen and covered him up, and he's still going on. I'm going to put him back further out, okay?
Don't bother. So it's fine. Okay.
Give me 1 second. He's a prick. He's always doing this. 1 second. He can hear me, and he doesn't understand why he's not part of the conversation. That's what that's about. So he's further back now.
But my dog might wander at some point with the same thought. Mainly will be, why haven't you fed me yet? Kind of thing.
Yeah.
But that's all right. I've got a technical difficulties thing with Brian Tucker on it that I like, that I have any excuse I want to use. So that's fine.
Cool. Yeah,
I
can throw that in there.
Which is funny, because we'll probably speak about him a little bit at some point. Where were we then? Where were we? That was, oh yeah, you're now managing.
Yeah, I managed, and I got that structure of where we were. And, you know, a couple of shows with Celtic, blah, blah, blah. And this is where I think most people will be interested now, because this is where I first came up to Scotland. Now, I was friendly with a wrestler by the name of Matt Vaughan, and he was booked on the show SWE, Hell for Lycra something, and it had Ted DiBiase on there, and God, there was one of the Highlanders.
Okay, right. Know. It'll be Rory, because I spoke to Rory. So yeah, so it'll be about it. No, I wasn't sure. Was it
maybe
nine?
Virgil was there then.
So was it eight? Was it 2011?
It might have been 2010, I think.
Okay, right. Okay.
It doesn't matter anyway.
Yeah, it doesn't.
It's really irrelevant to this. So I went up there with him, and that's the first time I would have met Alan and Randy. And as I want to do, because I know Randy will love this, I wasn't part of that show. I wasn't booked for it. I just went up to watch it. And I'm in the crowd. And Randy Valentine, against a wrestler we can't talk about anymore, but he had the worst match I've ever seen in my life. And I, to this day, am devastated. There's no footage of it anywhere. But I know he loves how I keep bringing that up. But it was abysmal. And I like Randy. I like Randy wrestling. I'm not knocking him or saying he's terrible, but he'd agree with that as well. So, yeah, and I met DBRC and things like that. And it was just nice to go up there. And then the next year was the one where they had Roddy Piper and DBRC was back. Chavo was there. Tatanka was there. So it was a big card. And by that time, I was more friendly with the guys. I'd been up for a couple of other shows before. And this time I was managing. I managed a wrestler by the name of Titan. There we go. We came out, and I believe it was young Brian Tucker we wrestled.
It was, because so, that was my first ever Scottish wrestling show. Was,
well, there you go. You've sort of met me.
So yeah, I've seen you from afar.
From afar, I'm not difficult to miss. It's like the moon, isn't it? Yeah. So yeah, that was the match, and it, you know, it was what it was. He came up there and he put Titan over, and it was a fun experience to go out there, and it was a fun experience to meet some of the guys backstage and talk with them. And you know, I become friendly with, I know I'm going to keep bringing this back, but of course there's a purpose for saying I was friendly with Alan and Randy at that point. And I came back here then, back to Wales, a couple of other companies, this, that, and the other. And then we shoot forward to 2014, which was the first Discovery show.
So we skipped a lot of bits there. So I'm going to go back a little bit then. So
yeah, sure.
Before then, we had the Goss Dynasty.
We had the Goss Dynasty, yes. Yeah.
So was that your Heenan family kind of thing?
Well, it was more a tribute to Paul Bearer and the Pringle Dynasty.
Right.
Okay. So when he managed as Percy Pringle, he had the Pringle Dynasty. So that's where I took that from. And it was fun to do it's always fun to do a faction like that. And selfishly, I sort of called it the Goss Dynasty. But as I realized with wrestlers coming in and out, it was wise to do, because as long as I'm involved in it, the name made sense. You know, as much as I dislike the thought of it all being around me, I work with still a friend of mine to this day. He wrestles as Danny Owens. He's got his own company called Carnage Pro Wrestling. So anyone who's listening to this from Wales, go and check them out. And I had a long issue with him back and forth. And I remember doing one promo where I stood on the stage, and I called him a little runt. And we had quite a few complaints because people thought I'd said something other than runt. Should we put it that way? And, you know, this is a family-friendly podcast, but just use your own imagination. So needless to say, I didn't. And those shows were fun. I mean, that was around that time is when I was chased into the bathroom by about 30 kids. And I was stuck. You're stuck in a cubicle. What can you do, you know? You can't come out swinging. And I'd walk around ringside and you get kicked. They try and trip you up. But it's fine as long as they didn't like me. That was the main thing. So I enjoyed managing, and the opportunity. I mean, I still carried on managing. I still did that and Discovery at the same time. But Discovery was solely commentating. Because I'd figured out reasonably how to manage, so I can sort of pull people aside and say, look, you're doing too much. You're taking the attention away from the person in the ring. And I'm able to say all this because I'm the one that buggered everything up for so many years. Mm-hmm. And you learn as you're going along, and you learn what you're doing wrong. And it's the same for wrestling matches. It's the same for everything. I'm a big believer that less is more. Mm-hmm. And I didn't say I ran my own company in that time as well. So just mention that. It was called Pure Catch. It was a nightmare. I was awful. I was the worst promoter in the history of humanity. And it lasted about a year.
I do have Pure Catch written down, because when you Google or YouTube, Darren T Goss, it's mostly Pure Catch that pops up.
Yeah. So there's a couple of things in there, and I try and avoid putting yourself on shows if you're promoting a show, but that's one that Matt Vaughn helped me a lot with. You know, again, if I don't speak to him anymore now, just it's life. Sometimes things change, and he's not involved in the business, and it just wasn't for me. And the reason I knew it wasn't for me is every match is set out for a certain amount of time, and one of the wrestlers who memory fails me now, he'd come down from England as a trainee, and he injured himself in the match, and he really hurt his arm. And I remember talking to him backstage, and he was apologizing, and I was so angry with him because he'd messed the flow of the match up. And I remember going home that night and thinking, I don't want to be that person. You know, that's not me. And I felt, and I still feel bad to this day, because that's not who I am, you know? So I felt really guilty about that, and that, and I just wasn't any good at it. I'm not that person, you know? I'm not a promoter. I'm not like so many others, like Alan and what have you, have got a good head for this. I deal with myself and the little that I do. I'm happy with that. So yeah, it was about a year. and it was what it was, you know. Nothing major to write home about, I'm afraid.
And before Discovery, there was a possible chance we were going to meet at one point. We've already mentioned the company, so it's fine. We were both in the SWV General Manager.
I got no memory of that. Sorry.
People want to forget, and they should. It was. I'd invited fans to do promos and stuff like that, and then you'd put one in as well. And someone who cannot be named also did, and we were all gathered in the ring, and I think you'd sent in like a 5-minute audio clip to play, and they only played like 60 seconds of it.
Probably just as well, yeah. I must have been told to do this. I'm sure this wasn't willingly me wanting to do it. I'm sure I was told to do this or asked to do it. I got a vague memory of sending that clip in.
When you speak about freezing in the ring, that was my first ever time with a microphone, and I just...
Oh, yeah, 100%. You'll know exactly what I mean then when you go out there. I probably would a bit today now because it's been so long since I've got up in the ring and done anything. I did it for Discovery once with somebody who also can't be named. They made me a bit of this today. It is, and again, you know, it's an intimidating thing because you're not used to it as a human being. It's not, you know, not public speaking isn't really something that happens. I mean, you don't go into Asda and grab the mic and start talking to everyone. You might, maybe people should, and they get better at this then.
But I will go into the tales here. I've done it in our podcasts where I have mentioned names I can't mention on here. So we'll just move on.
Yeah, I know it's difficult, isn't it?
I try. This is supposed to be a positive podcast.
You got me on it. This is a laugh, isn't it? Most miserable human being in the world.
The positive podcast. We've already went fans. Just come on, grow up. Anyway, so
small minority of fans. I said not Discovery fans. They're fantastic. Every single one of them.
Speaking of Discovery, then this is where the meat and potatoes of this podcast is probably going to be about. Is Discovery Wrestling. So.
Yep.
Incepted in 2014. Of course, I have a lot of facts in my head recently because I did the all about the disco story so far. So yeah. I have a lot of things whirling about it. How did Alan approach you? It was Alan and Alex Filas at the time, but how did they approach you with this concept and they wanted you on commentary? What was the backstage about that?
Well, Alan and I had a minor falling out. And once we realized it was nothing we'd done, but certain other parties, as you can probably guess where I'm going, then, okay. So he talked to me, and he had this concept of having commentary on the show, but not two Scottish commentators. So it would stand out a bit. So you'd have one Scottish voice and then another voice. So he'd asked me if I wanted to do it. Now, I'd never, ever, ever done commentary before. So I was happy to do it. I wanted to come up. I was happy because it had been like 3 years or so since I was up in Scotland. And so I was happy to come back and reconnect with everyone. And I was happy to start a new chapter with this and think, oh, right, commentary is something I'd always wanted to do, but the situation had never presented itself. So that was it. Alan messaged me and we had a little chat and we had a catch up. And that was it. I was like, yeah, I'm happy to do it. Let's go. And that was it, really.
And of course, Randy being your
well, Randy had done it before. So the first few shows, even today, going up there, Randy takes the lead. Mm-hmm. And he is the one that steers the ship. And I'll always say that. And I'm the one that makes it pretty. I'm there for the looks. You know, I'm there for the people can care. Basically, because they're not going to care about Randy because he's considerably older than me. So he could go at any time on commentary. Any minute you look at him and you think this could be it for him. So someone needs to step in, and that's why I'm there.
Was there any, like I think I spoke to Randy about it, did our episode with him, but was there any concerns when you was going to be Randy thinking he's not going to do the American accent the whole time, is he?
That was addressed beforehand. That wasn't going to happen. And that would have all come from Randy. He did one or two of those, which would have been, it would have been a nightmare for him, having to put a voice on top of everything else. But no, he realized our job there, which it was then and it is today, is to put the guys over, guys and girls over. Excuse me, I'm drinking water.
That's all right. It's legal.
You've got to clarify that it's not vodka. It looks like it. Wish it was. But I can't put over Randy enough, as much as I joke about him, and he knows that, and we've just been great. Well, I mean, God, next year it's 10 years, you know, it's 10 years, so it's gone very quick, but it's 10 years of doing commentary with him, and yeah, I've really enjoyed it. It's really been good, and so I took the commentary back to some friends. One I admitted. Omitted, I should say, though he should be admitted into a mental hospital. Probably can't say that, but there you go. By the name of Joe, who I can't name because he's very into kayfabe. So I can't tell you where he works or under what gimmick he works, but I was able to send him a lot of my stuff, a lot of the commentary, and he gave me abusive feedback, which is what I wanted. So bit by bit, I got better at it, you know, and to the point that I there's no complaints. And if people are happy with it, Alan's happy about it, it's fine. It's, I look at what I do now over the past few years and think, that's been pretty good, actually, you know, which is before I would never have said that because I'm very harsh at myself. But I think we're definitely in a good stride now, Randy and I, and I hope people feel the same way.
Well, I mean, it's something I certainly enjoy. I tried, because it was during this pandemic thing, I was like, oh, no, I've never tried commentary. I'll give it a go. So I got a match up, got a match sent in from Taylor Bryden sent me the match because he was like, it hasn't gone out yet, or hasn't gone out at all, so it's fresh. You can watch it. I did the commentary. Jesus, it is a lot more difficult than it ever is presented to. Like it sounds like a difficult job anyway because you got to keep people engaged, got to keep it interesting. But I was watching this going, I'm trying to stop myself just watching. I've got to actually say words to go with it.
Again, I'm not naming names, but there's a lot of people that do struggle to realize you don't put yourself over. Mm-hmm. And I think I've seen a lot of people that do. And I don't think they're probably even aware of that. But especially a lot of wrestlers that do it, because, of course, it's not even a knock on them, but they're so used to doing promos of themselves. Mm-hmm. And I think, for me, it probably helped being a manager because my promos are about other people anyway. So I think that was definitely a massive benefit for me was being a manager and doing promos for other people. And then you go in there and learn. And that's just from studying other people, how they've done commentary, what they do, what they say, why they say, oh, excuse me, I got wind. I do apologize, people. So, yeah, but I really do enjoy it, and I hope people are happy with what we do, and I hope it adds something, and I hope the guys and girls are happy with it. And as long as they are, then I'm good with it.
So you mentioned like studying things like Cornette and Heenan as well, when it came to not only as the managing side of things, but of course these are quite prolific commentators as well. Was that a conscious decision that, when you watch back things now, is it more of a commentator head that you're watching it with, like going, oh, did this little thing that I might bring into it?
Oh God, everything I do I've stolen from Heenan. It's not even a question. It's what I did, but no, I watch a lot of, I'm watching more heel stuff. There was a time Randy wasn't there and I did commentary on my own and then I did commentary with somebody else. So I'm the lead commentator and I've got to be more of a straight guy doing it. No, it's not great because it's not my comfort zone. You know, all of a sudden being this guy, I need to put people down to build them back, to build them up, if you know what I mean. You know, I've got a way of doing it and my way of just, of doing what Randy does is much more difficult than doing what I do. You know, being that straight guy is much more difficult than, you know, being the play-by-play more than the color. But I think there's also a mix of it, you know. It's not a straight role that way. You know, there's sometimes I'll step in and call things and, you know, and there's other times Randy can step in. So there is a mix. Well, usually people will say you've got to have a you know, a play-by-play, and then you've got to have a color commentator. And maybe they're right, but for me and Randy, it just works what we do that way. But yes, certainly, again, Joe, who, you know, he helped me out a hell of a lot. And, God, Dean Ayers is another one. I spoke to Dean a lot, and Dean gave me lots and lots of good feedback. So I've tried, and there's a lot of other people I messaged that wouldn't help, didn't want to help, or just ignored me, which again is something I would never do to anyone, but it is what it is. That's fine. So that's the only way you get better. The best way you can get better is to get as much feedback as you can, and quite frankly, as much criticism as you can, because that's how you learn. But a lot of people don't like criticism, and there you go. So tangent. Yeah.
I'm one of those people. So if anyone has anything bad to say about my podcasting, don't leave me alone. Just leave me to enjoy what I do.
There's criticism and then there's constructive criticism. That's the thing. You need to be, as long as people are constructive about what you're doing, don't just say, oh, you're crap, or whatever you're doing. Oh, it's rubbish. Well, why is it rubbish? Just don't like it. Don't give me, if a fan doesn't like something, that's fine. They don't have to excuse it. But if you can break down what somebody's doing, which I did last week, I listened to some commentary from somebody and I was able to give them a lot of feedback. It's like, I'm not going to name who it was, and it's nobody any of you guys would know anyway. But after every move, they would go, oh, my God, oh, my God. And I said, well, you keep doing that. But when they do something which is either going to lead to the finish or something really spectacular, what are you going to say? You've already done everything. It's like if you have a match and they go through tables and barbed wire and fire in the first 5 minutes, what do you do for the other 10 minutes? So, but there we go. That's, again, trying to behave, got to be positive. You get me on as a positive podcast. That's the biggest rib ever. So,
but again,
Billy, where are we going next?
I'm still on this because I had the same thing. That's why I did that little like demo thing for myself, because I was watching shows. Again, won't name it. Although if you find it in my reviews, you'll find out which one it was quite easily. I was watching a show and the commentary was just bad. The thing annoyed me most is they couldn't call move names, and they barely knew who was on the show, so they didn't do any notes, which irritated me so much. I thought, I could do this, and I did it. I went, no, I can't. But yeah, it was just one of those things where I'm listening to it going, no, you've not done the bare minimum work to do this, so
yeah,
you shouldn't be doing it, kind of thing. And I'm saying this to someone who hadn't done it, so I was like, I'll show you, you'll see. And I did it. I was like, no, it's a bit more difficult, but I still think I did a better job. Anyway,
it's just trial. If you want to do it, then just keep doing it, you know. Again, you're not going to do it once and be perfect at it. Mm-hmm. I wasn't. Just keep at it, you know. That's the advice I give for anyone for anything. Just keep going.
So that's where I'm at episode 200 and whatever of this podcast, and I'm still no better, but we're still trying.
Around about 1,000, you might start to hit your stride.
Maybe. Who'll be like, maybe, speak to them. I might get Grado on for the second time at that point. Right, so we've got where we at then. So at that point, you said you were still doing some managing. You're doing some bits at Reckless Intent. The Goss Dynasty was still kind of active at that point. I think you had Dickie Divers in there somewhere.
Yeah, that came later on. So I was doing managing back in Wales, and it would have been a couple of years into Discovery then, and I started doing stuff with Reckless Intent. And I still am very close friends with Michael Chase. Mikey is a great guy. He was running the company then, and yeah, just came in there, because usually it would work quite well, because a lot of times there'd be a Reckless show on the Saturday and then a Discovery show on the Sunday. So I could come up and I could do both of them. As far as Reckless goes, my number one memory and the thing I enjoy, my favorite thing as a manager was, we actually did a show on my birthday, and we had this birthday cake which went into my face. And I really enjoyed that, but I nearly died doing it, because it was Sugar Dunkerton and Grado, and they rammed the cake in my face and they didn't let me up. So the cake had just all built up down my throat and I had no breath going. So everyone's holding me laughing and I can't move. And I'm like, this is it. This is how I die. And I wasn't fussed on there, because you see a lot of people were very happy this is happening to me if you look at any of the footage, because they're all scum. What can I say? Every one of those wrestlers that held me there is all scum. And but yeah, no, that was great fun. That was my nod to Jim Cornette, that thing. So that was my favorite thing as a commentator. I've done it before. I've had my face put in lots of different cakes, but I've never nearly died. So I think I gave more to the business that night. I don't know how many people have died from having a cake put in their face, but so I hope that's a first in wrestling. So yeah, we did a lot of stuff. I Uncle Bobby and some of the Bullet Club, the Buffet Club came over and I managed them in Reckless as well. And I, to this day, got a really good friendship with Uncle Bobby now. He's living over in Canada, Rob Cage. And he's having a good old time over there. So, yeah, and a lot of the journey is making friends, you know, knowing good people up there. And Theodorus is another one. Very short person, little Greek person with a mohawk, but really good friend of mine. And who else? So, as you say, I managed divers. God, I don't know. Tell me, what did I do? I have no idea. I don't remember these things.
I mean, I remember why Sugar Duncan liked when I announced that you were going to be on the show. He did like it. So, like the old status. So,
oh, yeah. I can't even remember. It was nearly killing me. That's right. No, he's a great guy.
What I do have noted, though, is you are a former champion in Reckless. Of course, being a Reckless Intent hardcore champion.
The greatest Reckless Intent hardcore champion. I defeated Randy Valentine via massage, pinfall. And I lost to Doug Williams, which is a very weird thing to say, via handshake. However, I am undefeated in a actual wrestling match. I did pin Danny Owens. So,
don't need to wrestle anymore when you're undefeated.
That's it. I mean, it's not like I'm going to say it was a gauntlet match and three other people beat the hell out of him and I just came in and pinned him. That would never be what happened. In fact, it was actually nothing like that. It was a very competitive match. But no, I just walked in there and pinned him and that was it, which is all he deserves. Look at this. Randy Valentine sent me a message. He can get stuffed. See? I messaged a lot of people and they think, God, he's got an ego. I just said, leave me alone because I'm doing this interview now. And I don't want people messaging me because I have to be on my phone. But there we are. Randy doing a run-in. I'm not going to read the message because it's probably obscene if it's coming from him.
We double check my messages to make sure he's not asking any questions or sending expletives at my end to try and put you off, which he hasn't for now. So we have got a bunch of questions, so we'll get to those because I think they're more about your time in Welsh wrestling because it's been sent by the Twitter account Welsh_wrestling. So that seems to make sense.
Okay.
So they're interesting because I don't know about, like, there's three questions, two of them I have no idea where they're going to go. One, I'm hoping that there's nothing really that we can't speak about. Anyway, so number one, 2-2 star jumps versus Kiss Me's ribs.
Yeah, this is someone failing at being funny. God, how do I explain all this now? Tutu was a trainee back down in Wales, and he was called Tutu because he was very, very nervous of doing anything in front of someone. So we had, I don't think it was me, I'm not taking responsibility if it was, had the bright idea that from Cardiff to Canton, where the wrestling was held, which is about a 20-minute walk, he would wear a tutu in front of everyone, and everyone would sort of laugh at him or what have you, and just to get him used to making a fool of himself in public. And he promptly quit. You know, a couple of weeks later, he was gone. Kiss Me is the name of, I know exactly who sent all this in, but I'm not going to dignify him with acknowledging him. God, how am I going to say this now? Somebody works in Burger King. Somebody works in Burger King, and his name actually is Kiss Me. So, and there you go. This is of no interest to anyone, but needless to say, someone who is failing at being funny here.
Oh, I'm very scared about the second question then. So it's ask him to explain the Chicken Battle Royale.
The Chicken Battle Royale. Okay, right. So one of the Celtic wrestling shows I booked for their sins, and the main event was a Battle Royale, Royal Rumble sort of thing. It started off by a wrestler going out, even though it was a Royal Rumble, and saying this was an invitational for him. It was, and which it wasn't. It was a Royal Rumble match, so that was wrong. There was one of the trainees got injured, and they ran and they said, "I'm not going to name names in this because it's not fair." They ran back to me and they said, "So and so has been injured. One of the trainees has been injured," and it was Eddie. Dennis, what Eddie Dennis, who was, you know, in NXT and all that. I can't remember what. Yeah, Eddie Dennis he worked as. And I said, was it Ed? Because he was booked to win the Rumble match. This would have, God, when was this? About 2009, say. So I said, was it him? And they said, no. And I said, oh, thank God. You know, just a dead trainee at ringside, as long as it wasn't him. Another one took a, I don't know how he did it. He sort of went over the top rope, managed to go through the second rope at the same time, and hit face down on the ring apron and nearly killed himself there. A referee decided to wrestle as a ninja, and he got thrown over the top rope and twisted his ankle. And it just became known. And after Burger King, I just called it the Chicken Battle Royale because it was just a cluster fudge, let's put it that way. So yeah, that was certainly a match.
Wow. So pretty much except Dennis not getting injured, everything that could go wrong went wrong, kind of match.
He didn't get injured. Yeah, he didn't get injured, and so that was a blessing that the person I wanted to win actually won. It was almost like a sudden death match because they were dropping like flies with it was all right. It was the main event. They'd all wrestled other matches and came back for the Rumble. So if you're going to get injured, do it then, because I don't care, because you're not wrestling again. And it's out to my, it's not my problem.
We do have our inane questions that we ask everyone, the ridiculous questions. Our first one being, what's your favorite dinosaur?
I think it's got to be a Velociraptor.
Nice and simple, right?
I think they're the most vicious and the smartest.
And the other question we ask everyone is, what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
I think sheep are very, obviously coming from Wales, there's going to be a lot of references to sheep towards me. So there are more sheep than people in Wales, by the way. So if they ever decide to uprise, they can take over. So which is the fear of every Welsh person. A couple of towns away from me, we don't know how it happens, but sheep keep getting onto the top of people's houses. So I think sheep are very underlooked. I don't think people realize the dogged determination of a sheep to climb on the roof, which means they could kill if they wanted to. I think a cow could only kill if it panicked and ran someone over, but I think we don't know the full potential of what a sheep can do.
Love it. I love that answer. I love this question. 2 years, I still love asking that question. The other thing we speak about, so we've done the questions, we've done the inane stupid questions I ask, is because Discovery is such a big part of your wrestling life now, for doing the commentary, and of course being very close with the whole setup of it, being friends with Alan and Randy, what have you. What have been some of your highlights of working in Discovery Wrestling, either as a commentator or just as Darren T Goss?
I think the main thing, and I think this is the thing that would come across for everyone if they really stop and think about it, it's the relationships you build up along the way. I've got friendships I know that if I was to never do anything in the wrestling business tomorrow, they'd still be there, you know? And of course, the majority of people wouldn't, because it's like anything. It's like going to work in an office. You quit, you might keep in touch with a few of them, but the majority aren't, because and it's an acquaintance, and the one thing you've got in common is you work in this show. So it's not a knock on absolutely anyone, but that's just how life is with everything. But there's people I'm very close with, and I'll go through them with you now. As I said, Joe before, Theodorus definitely is one of my closest friends. All these people are, but he's gone above and beyond. And I want to shout out to the only really good thing about Theodorus, which is his dog Tyson. So I want to name drop Tyson. Alan and Randy, you know, they're like brothers to me. You know, they really are. We've all been through a lot together, and they've been there for me in a lot of difficult times. And I really, really, really means a lot to me. One of the newbies over the past few years has been Jack Morris. And yeah, just going through a lot of stuff with Jack as well. And, you know, he's a really, really good guy. And my God, he's got such a phenomenal future in front of him. He really, really has. So, and oh, big Johnny Pugs, you can't forget him. Big Kuma, who I don't know if you've seen his incredible weight loss journey.
I've seen bits of him. He's quite quiet on social media. He's quite a private person, but I've seen some.
Oh, yeah, he's lost dozens of people in weight. Let's just put it that way, literally, not dozens. But he's done a great job, and I'm really proud of what he's done there. So, yeah, anyway, that's not really your question, is it? Highlights would be the Elite Show and not being able to hold the microphone properly. The show where we had Kenny Omega and the Young Bucks. It was something really special. You know, we had and then there was another show where we had Cody there. Chris Sabin in the first show, and there was a very unlikely friendship between me and Chris Sabin. So, who else have we had? We had Sugar Dunkerdone over there a few times. He's a great guy. But yeah, I really think one of the most memorable moments will be that Elite show. You know, it was something really special. The fans were into it, and it was good. And it just showed, you know, it really showed what the fans can do, and what, you know, the wrestlers coming together, we can all do as well. And so it wasn't just about those three. It was about all of us. You know, it didn't look like they just come into this company and obviously, you know, really, really stood head and shoulders above everyone else. Who they wrestled that night, in my opinion, were equals to them in that match. The presentation of the company looked great. Everything about it, and they fit in, and I know they were happy with it there. And I know I'm going to be missing a hell of a lot of stuff now. And I'm unable to hold my camera. Oh God, this camera phone. So yeah, I would think there's there for me, as I say, personally, is the relationship, the friendships, but from an actual show point of view, got a point at that one. And I do love the Halloween ones we've done as well. We had a zombie match. Mm-hmm. We had all sort of business. We had a Nightmare on Elm Street street fight where two other great guys, the best tag team in the UK, call it whatever you want, the Kings of the North, just absolutely fantastic. Two great guys as well, so talented. They came out in like Freddy Krueger clothes, which I appreciated. So. Just loads of money. There's not been a Discovery show where there's not been something I've really enjoyed. Everybody who goes out there, I haven't got a bad word to say about anyone. They go out there and they put the graft in, you know. There's a lot of, and again, highlights for me is some of the younger guys. You've got Ryan Richards, who's got unlimited potential. You've got, oh God, there's so many we've seen on there. Ian Skinner, look at the card that we just had on June 3rd for Reckless. And there's so many names on there, you know, up and coming. And I think that's what Discovery can be now, is to discover new guys. And we'll see a lot of that on July the 1st as well, because what's happening on July the 1st, Billy, everybody knows this.
Oh, of course, they'll all know that Disco Darby's coming.
Everyone's talking about this. You know, I go out into the street. People that don't even know what wrestling is. I've heard of the Disco Derby. They don't know what's going on. They don't know what it is, but they've heard about it. And because it's the biggest event that Discovery does. You know, we've got that Disco Derby match, and I can't wait. I think it's going to be absolutely fantastic. I'm not going to tell you who's in that match, who's in that derby. You've got to find out yourself. The names are being announced as we go along. And my pick to win it, do you want to know who my pick to win it is?
Go for it.
The last man in the ring who gets his hand raised. That's going to be the guy. So I will tell you my pick to win it at the end of the match and see if I was right on it.
That's absolutely fair. That sounds it.
So that's July 1st at the
Edinburgh Sports Pleasant Sports Complex.
There you go. Oh, come on. That's a mouthful. Said the bishop to the choir boy. So, yeah. and on that bombshell, I think
I think we've pretty much covered it. Before we go then, so we kind of, in about an hour, we've scooted through 15 years of Darren T. Goss. We've got your highlights from Discovery. We've had some interesting stories as we've went along. Is there anyone in the future that you said, you mentioned some guys you've seen the upside of, like your Ryan Richards and Ian Skinner, and a guy that you'll have seen at this point and I'm hoping for big things is Ronan King as well. He would have been on that Livingston show. I'm sure he did phenomenally as well against Judas Gray, because that match just screams amazing.
Yeah.
Is there anyone that you want to commentate for? Is there anyone that you've watched and thought, oh, I can make them bigger on a media platform with my words?
Anyone who is going to use their brain to further themselves correctly, anyone who's got passion for the business, anyone who's realizes what they're doing there, then yeah, those guys. I'm not going to name anyone in particular, but anyone who puts the graft in, and it can be seen by people who put the graft in, people who have absolute passion for this, and are always willing to learn, always willing to take constructive criticism. Those are the guys, those are the ones that are, so I'm not going to name specific people because it's a process that goes across. So you might see someone who's doing absolutely fantastic now, and in a year's time, they've got someone pregnant and they don't want to do this anymore. You know, I've seen it a million times. So they've got all the potential in the world, and in a year's time, this isn't really for me. So that potential was, you know, that drive, that passion wasn't really there. There are everyone you named, all the guys and girls that are coming up at the moment, every single one of them has got that opportunity, and it's whether they're going to take it to take that step forward. And I would, if you were going to ask me for any advice on, I could tell them, watch what everyone else does and try and be different from it. That's the main thing, because there's 100 people out there that a Johnny wrestler who want to do a match that they like, maybe not the match that the audience like, and that's your main target, is the fans out there. So I have avoided your question like a politician by just blithering on endlessly, which is my gift to the world. So,
well, I mean, yeah. I guess the point, if you blither on long enough, I'll forget what question I asked in the first place. So,
I don't even know. I'm on the phone to someone now. This is just me sat in the house on my own talking to myself now. So,
perfect.
There's loads of guys, there's loads of potential coming, you know, whether they work for any company, whether they're all over the place. There's so many guys coming up, there's so many great training schools. With Joe Hendry training people, with Andy Roberts, and it was close, I'm getting there. Andy Roberts is training. There's so many guys up there, and they're showing the passion, and especially with trainers like that. You see how well Joe's doing. There's great, and there's so many other schools that I can't remember now, because I'm, folks, believe it or not, I'm approaching 40, just from the wrong direction. So
that's right. Again, I'm now approaching mid-30s, and my memory's just, I have to have everything written down if I'm going to remember it. That's a nice way to kind of round up the show and to kind of finish off. I think we got through without any naming anyone particularly awful.
We behaved, I behaved.
I think my inbox is safe from any possible recourse, but you know, who knows? That's the mystery. That's the fun. So thank you very much for joining me on the show. Anything you want to plug before we stop?
Discovery Wrestling. Go and see it at Disco Wrestling on Twitter, at Discovery_Wrestling on Instagram, which I hope is right. And on Facebook, Discovery Wrestling. Just go and look at Discovery Wrestling, kids. Just type it in. There's stuff on YouTube to watch. There's loads of things on there. If you're not a fan of Discovery, give it a chance. Go along there. July 1st, Disco Derby. In that sports complex you said, which for reasons beyond my control, I can't name. I don't know why, but I can't remember their name. But yeah, come along to the Disco Derby. Come along, get your tickets, get them there. Come and see why that's the biggest event of the year, and see not only the present of wrestling, but see the future of wrestling as well.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much.
No problem. Bye-bye.